So Daniel chapter 1. Why Daniel? Well, as we studied 2 Kings coming to chapter 24, we came to the time of the king Jehoiakim. And I say Kim because that's to differentiate it from Jehoiakim with an N at the end in English, which was his son. But Daniel begins his prophetic work with setting the time of his ministry beginning, in a sense, in the third year of Jehoiakim, and then sets the end of his ministry time at the close of the first chapter in verse 21, when he says that he was there until the first year of Cyrus the king. And that sets a very good time kind of line for us, because as Daniel ministers to the several kings that Nebuchadnezzar's father, then Nebuchadnezzar, and then Belshazzar, and then Darius, and then the Medes and the Persians and Artaxerxes. I mean, it's a big deal, and we're going to span, as it were, not just the 70 years that Jeremiah prescribed that God would require from Israel in being captivated in Babylon, but Daniel lives a little longer than that. And it's an intriguing life, and I think it's a noteworthy life because Daniel was a young boy, a man who refused to compromise his life, irrespective of what that meant physically, emotionally, and I think at times even requiring his life. Well, Ray Stedman once said that the book of Revelation explains the book of Daniel, and the book of Daniel lays the basis for the book of Revelation. So we will be, after now finishing 2 Kings, we're going to be going through Daniel, and then we're going to be taking a look at a portion of Obadiah, a portion of Joel, and then Nehemiah, and then on to the book of Revelation. So big things are ahead of us, and I'm very excited about all this. I think a lot of you were probably a bit concerned about the weekend because of not only Shana Tov, Rosh Hashanah, but also because of what was prescribed by some happening to the world yesterday with this invisible planet, Planet Nibiru or Planet X striking the Earth yesterday, and I don't think it happened secretly because I didn't hear about it. Did you? Yeah, but does it bother you some that the reputation of the cause in the Church of Christ is affected by these people that just go off on tangents and make up planets and these so many prescribed to that and you know, Y2K, how many of you remember that? I was here. And I'm still here. Everybody was concerned about what was going to happen as the sun rose over New Zealand and whether, you know, reservoirs would crack. And really, nothing happened. And then, you know, here we are living through the kind of pressures. I know of some Christians that were really very personally concerned. Well, you know what? Our concern should be focused on the lost, really. Our concern should be to live as Daniel lived without compromise, prescribing, consecrating our life to a life of holiness. Now, holiness to different people means different things, I know. And you know, the church has attempted in many ways, some ignorantly, to prescribe what holiness looks like. But I want you to know this morning that holiness is something given to you by the blood of Jesus Christ. Righteousness is yours because of Jesus. Now, that righteousness and the love for God's word should indeed mold and change your life as I choose every morning to consecrate and reconsecrate my life and my devotional time to Jesus Christ. And maybe I'm a little more blockheaded than you, but I need to do that every single morning. I need to dedicate and rededicate my life to the purpose of Christ, to build eternity in people's lives, to change focus, to change perspective, and really come in line with God's purpose and plan for my life, because I know He has a perfect personal plan and purpose for my life, and I know that He has one for you as well. And I truly believe He wants you to know that perfect plan and purpose. And I know He wants you to know His Word, and oh my goodness, how the Holy Spirit will move us, our compassion toward the Word of God. We sang this morning about hungering and thirsting for righteousness. As the deer panteth for the water brooks, so my soul panteth after you. Oh, to have a life that pants for the water brooks of God's Word, for the streams in the desert, to have a sense about us that I cannot live today without the anointing of the Lord in my life. I don't know if you have a devotional life. I think many more women, Christian women, have a devotional life than Christian men. Some have suggested it's very difficult for a man to think in those terms. But I want you men to think in this term, to dare to be a Daniel today. To say in your life, you know what, I can spare 5 minutes, 10 minutes, 15, 20 minutes in the morning. And maybe you get up late, but it's time for you to get up in the morning. It's time for you to get out of the sheets, get on your knees, and seek the face of God, that you would bless Him that day. And that you would not necessarily go with the flow. And sometimes a consecrated life that doesn't go with the flow is a life that changes other people's lives. And we're going to see that this morning in the first 8 verses of Daniel chapter 1. Daniel begins this wonderful testimony of how, and really the first 6 chapters are part of that history. And then chapters 7 through 12 are part of the prophetic word that God moved Daniel in. But I want you to see this morning in these first 8 verses how Daniel made choices concerning his life that you and I should make concerning our lives today. Now, I wasn't raised in a Christian church, even though it was called a Christian church. And by the way, it wasn't a scientific church either, even though it was called Christian Science. It's neither Christian nor scientific. And in fact, I learned very few things concerning Jesus as God. But we sang a lot of the Sunday school hymns that a lot of the other churches sang. And you, being raised in a Christian church perhaps as a child, may remember the Sunday school hymn, Dare to Be a Daniel. How many of you ever sang that in Sunday school? Okay, about 3 or 4 of us. All right. Hallelujah. Here are the words. Standing by a purpose true, heeding God's command, honor them, the faithful few, all hail to Daniel's band. The refrain, the chorus at each of the end of these verses is, dare to be a Daniel, dare to stand alone, dare to have a purpose firm, dare to make it known. What a great way to think as you begin each day. Dare to make it known. The purpose firm. Second verse goes, many mighty men are lost, daring not to stand, who for God had been a host by joining Daniel's band. Many giants, great and tall, stalking through the land, headlong to the earth would fall if met by Daniel's band. Last verse, hold the gospel banner high, on to victory grand, Satan and his host defy, and shout for Daniel's band. Now, in Sunday school, there's a little march that goes along with that. And I talked with our worship leader, and I thought, you know, maybe we could do a little marching this morning. But it doesn't work out too well when you have this many people. But to dare to be a Daniel, think of that, to dare to live a life consecrated to Christ, to not be like the church of Jesus Christ, but to be the church of Jesus Christ. Oh, I think that's the Lord's greatest desire. Isn't it He who in fact moved Paul to write in Ephesians 5 concerning Jesus' love for His church, His bride? And he says, He gives up his life for her and washes her with the water of God's word so as to present unto himself a bride without spot, without blemish. I don't know about you, but I didn't become a teenager hoping that I'd marry a prostitute. I don't know many young boys that would think, gee, I hope I marry a prostitute. Some gutter snipe that's filthy-minded and, you know, kind of like some of the party girls that think that's where, you know, real life is all about. Jesus wants to marry a perfect bride. By the way, a bride who loves to be washed by the Word of God, whose hands are clean, whose heart is pure, from Psalm 24, a bride, a church that is so empowered by the Word of God that it lasts with you all week. It's that which presents its wakening call to arms in the morning. It's that which sings the taps at night. It's that which you hope you will dream about. It's that which you hope you will wake with. It's that which you pray that your children and your grandchildren will be motivated by far more than anything else in life. Own friends, you know. Because maybe you had a life like mine. I didn't meet Jesus until I was 23. And the interesting thing is those first 23 years of my life, what a life. I don't think you would recognize me. I hate to think of what I did and where I went and what I thought about, what motivated me in those days, and things changed so immensely. That night, Jesus came into my life. And I recognized at that moment that I had a purpose. God had a plan for my life. And thank you, Jesus, that you shoved me a square peg into the round hole of Calvary Chapel, Costa Mesa, and the Word of God was central to my life. And I loved the Word of God. And I loved reading and studying Scripture. I've always been Calvary Chapel. I've pastored other churches, but I've always been Calvary Chapel because I've always loved the Word of God. And I know that God is not finished with me yet. How about you? And so that's why I need to be reconsecrated on a daily basis. I need to spend time with Jesus at some point during the day where I can download, where I can be directed by His Holy Spirit through His Word to a life more like Jesus. Oh, to dare to be a Daniel. Oh, the influences today that your children come home from even elementary school anymore, from junior high, from high school, from college. And sometimes you wonder how your child is going to make it through the hurdles and the great quicksands of life experience, but you know deep within your heart that the Word always succeeds in that for which it's sent. It never returns unto the Lord void. And parents, we speak the Word of God into our children's lives, our grandchildren's lives. If we live long enough, Lucy and I will speak the Word of God into our great-grandchildren's life. Because the heritage of faithfulness is a heritage that I believe made a difference in Daniel's life. Almost every commentator suggests, we don't know perfectly, but suggests that Daniel was stolen away with hundreds of other young kids his age out of Jerusalem at about the age of 12 or 13, at the point where a young man would be bar mitzvahed and a young lady would be bat mitzvahed. In other words, essentially referred to as an adult at that point, rightly and intimately, personally handling the Word of God as an adult, responsible for the Word of God, responsible for their actions, responsible indeed for the choices that they would make each day. And as they watched their parents, as they were taught in Hebrew school, as they were taught in the liturgy of the Hebrew faith church, They learned things that would become the non-negotiables of their life. And I've met so many, particularly on a baptism day, we ask them, how did you come to know Jesus as their Savior? And so often they mention vacation Bible school, they mention Sunday school, they mention their parents. All such powerful things that bring about the formation of a child's life to say in their hearts, I will dedicate my life to the service of the Lord. And the challenges come, you know. The challenges came to Daniel. And he dared not only to be a man of prayer. I mean, who in Old Testament could come close to the manner and the regularity that Daniel prayed? Consecrating himself to fasting, consecrating himself indeed to not just do what all the other boys and girls did that came to Babylon, but to do what God told him to do, even at the age of 13, 14 years old. In the third year of the reign of Jehoiakim, king of Judah, it says in Daniel chapter 1, verse 1, Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, came to Jerusalem and besieged it. We know this, of course, also from 2 Kings chapter 24. But note this, and the Lord gave Jehoiakim, king of Judah, into his hand, with some of the articles of the house of God, which he carried into the land of Shinar, to the house of his God, and he brought the articles into the treasure house of his God. We know from Daniel chapter 5 that there was not a good use for the gold articles from the temple. And Baal-Shazzar used those articles in his hedonism, in his debauchery, in the mayhem of orgies in the name of the god of Babylon. And the king was the god of Babylon, besides the many other gods. And all of a sudden that night in the midst of the party is crashed by the hand of God, writing on the wall. And it frightened the people so sincerely that they sought someone to read that writing. And I don't think it was written in Hebrew necessarily, because certainly many of those at the point where Belshazzar was king could have read Hebrew because of the influence or perhaps the connection with the Hebrew kids that had come many years earlier. I think it was written in a language that Daniel immediately saw and understood because he saw that it was his father's handwriting. I don't know about you, I had parents that scratched like a chicken, and honestly, us three kids were the only ones that could read it. And I could tell from my mother's handwriting, her handwriting, probably from any other handwriting in the world. Daniel, brought before the king, things are happening in front of him that certainly should have vexed his heart, particularly seeing the very articles, the tools of worship in the temple of God in Jerusalem being used in such an ill manner. And he sees the writing and immediately recognizes his father's hand, and he speaks many, many tekel upharsin and says, this is what the God of Israel says. You have been weighed in the balances of God, and you have been found wanting. It crushed the king. It would crush any one of us. I would propose for you to hear that you have been weighed in the balances of God, and that weight, and in Hebrew, the literal term for glory means weight. The weight of glory is missing in your life. I want to have a keen perspective in my life. For all have sinned, fallen short of the glory of God, Paul wrote to the Romans. Fallen short of that, which means the weight of the glory of God is not resident in you because sin has stolen it away. The connection between Romans 3:23 And Daniel chapter 5 is an intriguing one because Paul uses those terms of Hebrew and Greek playing against them many times. A very, very intelligent man. How have I fallen short of the weight of God's glory? By exchanging the truth for a lie, knowing what is right to do, James 4:17, and simply choosing not to do it. Sin is not popular today. The idea or being challenged that if you're a sinner, you need to confess your sins because he's faithful and just to forgive you your sins and cleanse you of all unrighteousness. We know that. But how often do we avail ourselves of that? How many mornings do you wake up thinking, I cannot live this day. I cannot walk in this world in the manner of sin that I perhaps walked in it yesterday. And to direct your life, as it were, actually it's God directing your life, the Holy Spirit speaking into your heart, and he's giving you the perspective with respect to your lack of the weight of God's glory. Why? Because all have sinned and we've fallen short of that great weight of glory. And all I want to do is pursue the glory, the weight of his glory that day. And that means I pursue Jesus because he is my glory. He is the substance of my being. I'm nothing without Jesus. Nothing. And the Lord gave Jehoiakim, king of Judah, into his hand. That's so intriguing to me. That the Lord, John in chapter 17, verse 1 says that Jesus has authority over all flesh. That Jesus, the pre-incarnate Jesus, decided the best solution for my nation, for my city, for my throne room in the Holy of Holies is to wipe it as a woman would wipe a plate. And to take this people back to ground zero. And I remember years ago sitting in the parking lot with a young man, he was a few years younger than me, and we were weeping over the situation in his life and in his business. And he said, Paul, how can these things happen? And I said, hey, you know, dear friend, these things happen to take us back to ground zero, to take us to a place where we will reconsecrate our life to a manner and to degree, perhaps like Daniel, to say, you know what, I will no longer compromise. I will no longer be influenced by the tribes I have run with previously. I will no longer run with the things that have addicted me in the past because I recognize that they steal the glory of God from me every single day. When will you get sick and tired of being sick and tired? And you know, suddenly, it's not an epiphany, it's just a recognition that God's word is suddenly true, and you realize, I have got to consecrate my life today. I've got to make a choice. I've got to dare to be a Daniel. Knowing that God will do anything to bring you back to him. And he did much to bring Israel back to him. Daniel would be in Babylon for over 70 years, which would take him into his 80s, most assuredly. But in that time, you never once hear Daniel say, I wish I wasn't here. You never hear Daniel praying to God, oh, you've got to get me out of here. You never hear Daniel complaining about the situation that he is in because, friends, he has chosen to be better, not bitter. He is chosen in his environment that God has planted him. And friends, I want you to know this morning, very personally, listen closely, you are in this place because God has put you here. God has planted you, and he would desire for you to grow roots. In this time, in this place, God makes no mistakes about where you live and what you do there. Well, brother, I'm not employed. I don't know where I live. Maybe I'm living under a tree and Waller Park. Again, I would say God has made no mistake. Isn't it time And honestly, I don't think having a mortgage or having six car payments or whatever is necessarily God's will for you. But I know this, consecrating your life, daring to be a Daniel, is God's will for you each day. It is God's will. You ask me, what's God's will for my life? Dare to be a Daniel. Dare to venture a life of growing glory because sin is diminishing. There's been hundreds of years that have come and gone since Daniel, that before Daniel came to Babylon, hundreds of prophecies, men of God that he sent into the streets of Jerusalem, certainly as Jehoiakim comes to the end of his reign, in the streets are great men like Jeremiah, a young man by the name of Daniel, that perhaps thought, well, today's not going to be much different than any other day. But in the course of his life, something was being established in him that could only have been established by parents who understood God's call in their life. And so when Daniel, outside of his parents' influence, with hundreds of other kids, are stolen away at spear point to a foreign city, hundreds of miles away, months of travel on dusty roads to get to Babylon. Arriving in Babylon, seeing a city that you've never thought you would have ever seen in any dream prior to that. The gardens of Babylon were considered one of the seven wonders of the world. The beauty of the landscape, of the pyramids, of the temples to many gods, the palace of Nebuchadnezzar, unlike anything that they had ever seen before, that rich amount of fresh water flowing because of the Euphrates and the Tigris and other rivers into the city. It was astonishing coming across, I suppose, the horizon to see Babylon for the first time. I wonder if these kids looking at that thought, oh, life is going to be different. We're told in verses 3 through 5 that something did happen that made their life quite different. That the king, Nebuchadnezzar, ordered his head butler, Ashpenaz, the commander of his court officials, to bring some of the Israelites from the royal family and from the lords. So these were people that had birthright that was pretty clear, I suppose. Youths that had no physical defect, well, there I go, who are handsome and who are prudent in all wisdom and endowed with knowledge and who understood insight. Interesting. How would you describe most 13-year-olds? Well, they quickly tell you they know everything and why you're wrong. Prudent in all wisdom, endowed with knowledge, and who understand insight. And I can tell you, because I was a teacher for 6 years in a public school and a Christian school as well, that the great frustration of many teachers is to see the capacity of a child under your tutelage, under your teaching, and know what they're capable of, and to realize that they just don't want to achieve what they could achieve. There's many family issues or many other issues. And it's heartbreaking for many teachers to see the end result of kids that are influenced by tribes or associations or a lack of identity or a lack of parentage or a lack of many things. And to think back in their mind, in your mind, what this kid could have been. What they could have been. So, they've brought these kids in to serve in the palace of the king, and the king ordered him to teach them the literature and the language of the Chaldeans. So they were to learn to read and write the Babylonian language, a difficult language, for the most part written in a Sanskrit. But boy, the libraries of the Babylonian culture are amazing, truly. There's a lot. And one of the more intriguing things about these libraries of the Babylonians is that It dealt with a lot of the mystical part of life that many of the Hebrews, as kids, didn't have really much to know about there. We talk about the Magi of the East coming to Jesus' birth, or when he was 2 or 3 years old. We're talking about the shamans, the witch doctors, the guys from the East who were well educated in the Babylonian mysteries, going all the way back to the days of Nimrod, you know, that really founded the city of Babylon in Babel. And these mystical arts, many suggest that were taught to them by the Nephilim. Some suggest that Nimrod himself was one of the Nephilim. Are the undescribable mystical arts and astrological ideas that these kids were now being forced to not only understand, but be useful in the presence of the king in describing, as it were, prophetic things? I would suggest actually pathetic things. To, as we'll find in the next chapter, an opportunity really to stand out among all others based on the literature that they had been taught to read and to study, and the language of the Chaldeans as well. Beyond that, we also discover that in verse 5, the king assigned to them his daily portion from the fine food of the king and from the wine that he drank, and instructed that they were to be educated for 3 years. And at the end of their training, they were to be stationed before the king. Now, to be stationed means that you're a fixture, in a sense. And to be a fixture in the king's court, in the midst of his harem, required that every man be castrated, so that the king would not be wondering during lunchtime what's going on with his harem. And the intriguing thing about this, it was the expression of power. It was the expression of a king over all the other men in his presence. The expression of virility that overshadowed now the lack of virility in all other men in his presence. It was the expression of indomitability. And we will discover in chapter 2 that Nebuchadnezzar presents a scenario to these young boys that has nothing to do with the language of Babylon or the literature of Babylon. That there is a God who indeed knows all things. And that same God knows all things with respect to your life as well. 3 years, much to learn. Much to be impressed by, particularly since none of these young kids had ever eaten the kind of food that the Babylonians would eat. Because, of course, they had no laws concerning the table or what could be presented there. All manner of animals would be not only slaughtered, but typically all animals would be presented to idols and then used in the king's court. And of course, they had, much like Nehemiah was in his book, cupbearers and tasters, people that would taste food before the king would, and the lavish tables that the king had. All day long, the leftovers would then be brought to these kids as they're studying Chaldean, and now they want them to be immersed in the luxuries of what it means to be chosen among these hundreds of kids to serve in the king's court. And I can imagine all of them doing whatever they could. Oh, I want this lifestyle. How many of you want the lifestyle of the rich and famous? I would venture to say it's probably a pretty ugly lifestyle. Every very wealthy person I've ever known has one thing on their mind. What are you trying to get from me? My money. Like, you know, Scrooge McDuck kind of thing, you know? And the weird thing about all this is that for some, and I can't imagine a single 13 or 14-year-old that wouldn't be absolutely overwhelmed with the food, with the wine, with the wealth of what was offered to them if they would conform. If you will be like what the king wants. But here we discover in verse 6 through 8 that these four boys, Daniel and his three friends, made it a point from the very beginning of arriving in Babylon that I will not be like you. And we'll discover in time who gets the favor of God. So, verse 6, now there was among them from the Judeans four boys, Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. And the commander of the court officials gave them names, and he called Daniel Belteshazzar, and Hananiah he called Shadrach, and Mishael he called Meshach, and Azariah he called Abednego. Now, nothing real important about those names other than they're the antithesis of what their names in the Hebrew mean. Worshiping, adoring, conforming to the God of Israel. Now, they are to worship, they are to adore, they are to conform to the gods of Babylon. But the change in their identity would not affect their spiritual DNA. How do we know that? Now, Daniel, verse 8, resolved that he would not defile himself. Now, how did he know what would defile him unless he had been taught well in Hebraic school by his parents, by example, because he was surrounded by the kids that did the same? The parents were careful about where Daniel spent his time and who he spent his time with. So Daniel, alone by himself, his parents are probably dead, may have even been killed right in front of him. Young babies, as the psalm later cries out, by the Babylonians were typically dashed to the rocks, which means grabbed by the ankles and smashed to the rocks, because they couldn't be bothered with having to feed and care for babies. At what age did that change? I don't know. But most of the kids standing in the king's courtyard with Daniel, perhaps hundreds of kids, were at an age where they could be taught and could conform, and Daniel said, no. I will not defile myself with the fine food of the king and with the wine that he drank. And so he requested from the commander of the court officials permission that he would not defile himself. So, you know, hey, butler, hello. Pay attention now. Look at me. Look at me in the eyes. I'm not going to eat your food. I'm not going to drink your wine. That doesn't mean he didn't drink wine. He just isn't going to drink the king's wine. I'm not going to conform myself to what you want. And honestly, that kind of dare would leave Daniel and his friends. Well, you know the story of the fiery furnace. You know the story of the lion's den. You know the story of nonconformity because they knew what was right before God and they consecrated that life to the Lord no matter what it meant. And the point of all that I'm saying today, as much as Joshua concludes the wonderful gospel of Joshua by saying, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Daniel had said about himself, as for me, I will serve the Lord. I will not defect. I will not be distracted. I will not do what the crowd does. And the intrigue, think about this. I mean, they wouldn't deal with babies because too high maintenance. Amazing to me that these satraps and shamans and witch doctors and all, when they looked across the crowd of the boys and girls that would be eventually chosen, and a few of them would be chosen, to actually stand in the court of the king, that God's favor fell upon the eyes of the unbelievers. And they saw something in the hearts and lives of Daniel and his boys, and recognize that there is something unique about these guys that I don't see in any other of the kids. Any other of the kids. What parent does not want their child to stand out because of holiness, because of consecration, because of a life directed by the Lord? What employer would not want a man or a woman in his or her employ that had one purpose in being there, and that was to seek the success of their employer. That's why we're employees, to seek the success of our employers, no other reason. And to live a life of consecration means that even unbelievers will recognize in your life there is something different, something unique, something that I want in my life as well, and my life is so out of control. Oh, I know the world recognizes their life is out of control. Weeks before I came to know Jesus, I knew my life was completely out of control. And I didn't have any idea what I could do about it. Had no idea. And when the Dean of Agriculture at Cal Poly Pomona said, "Paul, I got you a slot to live at the poultry unit at Cal Poly. You get to live there. There's two other guys living there." And I don't know what he saw in me. Perhaps the Lord gave him eyes to see the opportunity for a man's life to be changed at the age of 23. And the moment I moved into that house, these guys didn't do anything different than they ever did previously. They just lived a life of consecration. And I saw in them clearly what I didn't see in me. And I wanted it. Oh, how I wanted it. Friends, you may be sitting alone in a crowd. You may be deferred and forgotten, much as David was from Jesse's family. You may be in the place that you are employed, someone that is the last to be chosen, the lowest on the rung of corporate whatever, and you think, "Lord, I know I'm living this life for you, but will I struggle? Will I need to struggle my whole life?" And I'm here to say to you, no, you won't. But you stay true to Jesus. You stay out of compromise. You choose carefully the tribe you run with. You're careful about the things that are presented to you that seem luxurious, but you know will ruin you in the end, and you will say like Daniel, "I will not defile myself." Oh, and you'll lose friends. Facebook, you know, the number of your friends. Speak the name of Jesus, number of your friends. Wear a Christian shirt. Pray openly. And life changes. But I am here to say to you, it changes for the better.